If I gave this image to my computer right now and asked it to tell me what exactly it is, what do you think the answer would be? Now, if you haven't by any chance tried to teach your computer the difference between a piano and a penguin, believe me, it's a lot harder than it sounds. But why is it that such simple tasks for us can be so daunting and complicated for a computer to do? Well, it all comes down to the way we process and see information versus the way that a computer does so. Let's take a look at a classic exam. This is an 8, but so is this and this. And even though I'm pretty sure that even your 6-year-old cousin would be able to tell you that these are depictions of an 8, let's try to understand what exactly it is that we are seeing. Essentially, these images are just different combinations of shadows, some darker and some lighter. And for us, these combinations mean that we are seeing the number 8. However, a computer doesn't process information, doesn't process images in that way. For it, what these images are is just a grid with different pixels with different values. So, for example, we can't just tell the computer that, hey, if you see these pixels, then that's the number 8. Because the pixels in this image don't match up with the pixels in that image. That's also an 8. Wait, so then how can we teach our computer to understand whether what we're showing is a picture of an 8 or a potato? Lucky for us, the answer is already there, and it's called a convolutional neural network. Neural networks are a type of computational system inspired by the way human brains work. Neurons are their basic building blocks, and hence the name neural networks. You can think of these neurons like knots that each hold a number, and these knots are connected to one another. And the connections of these knots have certain weights attributed to them. These weights are in place to represent the strength of the connection between the neurons, or in other words, how important their connection is to the final outcome or the final prediction. The convolutional part of the name comes from the first few layers of the network, which are called the convolutional layers. And what they do is run our image under a series of filters in order to detect whether certain patterns are evident in the image or not. So for example, there could be an edge detecting filter or a circle detecting filter. These types of filters usually go under the category of less complex and simpler filters, which usually are in the first convolutional layers. And then the patterns that they recognize are fed into the deeper layers, which usually make more complex and sophisticated representations of the data. So, for example, looking back into our numbering example, the first layer could detect whether certain ellipses or half circles are evident, and the second could later say that, hey, this is a circle. After that, at the end, a so-called fully connected layer is able to combine all of these learned patterns, all of these learned features, in order to predict what the image is showing. So for example, here if we had 2 circles, the model would say, hey, that's probably an 8. Or if we had a circle and a line, that may be a 6 or a 9. But wait a minute, how exactly does my computer learn? The process which we just described is called a forward pass, the outcome of which is a prediction. And after that, what we need to do is compare our true value to that of the predicted value. And in order to quantify that difference, we use something called a loss function. You can think of a loss function like a magic wand that allows us to understand how to punish different values according to how far or close they were to the target value. Now, in reality, there is a lot of math behind what exactly the loss function is and how it works, but let me walk you through an analogy that helped me understand the concept when I first heard about it. Imagine you're standing on top of a mountain range. It's night, and you're only holding a flashlight in your hand that allows you to see the slope you're standing on. Your goal is to reach the lowest point of the mountain range, and in order to do that, you start walking towards a direction where the slope goes visibly down. You take bigger steps when the slope is bigger, and smaller steps when the slope is smaller. Eventually, you will have reached a point where the slope is equal to 0. Now, let's turn the mountain range into our loss function, and yourself into the algorithm. The algorithm starts at a random point of the function, and navigates across it in a similar way that you walked across the mountain range, trying to find a minimum point. How it manages to find the lowest point
Now that's a story for another time.
In this way, the computer can understand how to fine-tune the parameters, how to fine-tune the weights in order to have the best possible prediction. If you ask me, CNNs are a very exciting example of what artificial intelligence can achieve. Since apart from teaching our computers how to tell the difference between pianos and penguins, they can be used in a variety of fields and innovations, from self-driving cars to drones that can detect fires or early signs of fires way before any human could. So really, the possibilities are endless, just as long as we keep exploring.